Excellent. So we're being recorded now. Continue. Excellent. I think I'll give them 2 or 3 more minutes just so that more people have the chance to arrive.
Yep.
And I guess we can cut the bit at the beginning, the chat for later then. But then I'll just introduce you now in a moment when we start. But let's just give them a couple of more minutes just in case there's people waiting.
Hi, Chris. Hi, everyone.
Hi, Camille. How are you?
Good, how are you?
I'm well, thank you. It's nice to see you.
Nice to see you too.
Are you in Istanbul again?
Yeah, it's Istanbul nighttime. Let me change it to
Oh,
daytime.
no. I'd love to be in Istanbul nighttime or daytime.
I think that's Golden Gate, right, Christian?
Is indeed, and is indeed.
Yeah, very similar.
That's why I hang out for my picnics.
You live there? You live in San Francisco?
No. I'm in Barrie. Another time, I'll
Barry.
have a picture of Barrie. Yes, in South
Yeah.
Wales.
Doesn't quite have the glamour.
Doesn't, but it has a nice beach. In all fairness, we have
It
a
does.
very
It
nice.
does. I used to go there a lot as a boy. Very nice. And go to the fair as well. Still love going to the
Oh, yeah.
fair.
Oh, our kids love that too. It's great.
I love it as an adult.
Yes, exactly. At the moment, it's not too much of it, but you know, hopefully soon again.
Hopefully.
More people coming. That's great. I'll give it until 35 and then we can start.
Yeah, by all means.
Right, so it's 35 on my watch. Shall we make a start?
Yeah, I'm very happy to.
Excellent. Right, good afternoon. Welcome to this joint event between the University of South Wales and Swansea University. We're absolutely delighted to have you here. We're absolutely delighted to have Kristen here at this joint event, something that we've planned for a while, that is part of a Jean Monnet module on EU resilience against hybrid warfare. It is part of a bigger project that involves a number of different research items that I'm sure Kristen is going to tell us a little bit about. It involves a number of different events. It also involves some teaching activities that are already happening here at the University of South Wales in the form of our master's teaching. It is part of our larger projects in terms of Jean Monnet funding. It is also part of our Jean Monnet Centre of Excellence virtual opening Britain to Europe and the world. And it is also linked to our Jean Monnet network in EU counterterrorism. So this is part of a lot of different activities that are on at the University of South Wales. And for this, we're so proud to have with Dr. Kris Stoddart, a real expert in the field of hybrid warfare with us. Kristen and I, we've talked about this for quite a long time. We've discussed this subject for quite a while, and it is most topical, especially now with the pandemic and with the fact that we have to do this online. So this is something unusually topical, and it is, of course, of high importance and significance. So we're delighted to have Kristen here. Kristen, just to give you a very brief background, although I'm sure a lot of you know Kristen already, just a very brief background. He's currently Associate Professor for Cyber Threats at the University of Swansea. He was formerly Reader in the Department of International Politics at Aberystwyth University, where he was also the deputy chair of the Center for Intelligence and International Security Studies. He's also currently with us, a visiting professor at the University of South Wales, which we're very proud to have him here as a visiting professor. From 2014 to 17, he worked on a project involving Airbus, and I'm sure he's going to tell us more about it, so I'm not going to talk too much about it. Just to tell you that he's a long-standing expert in this particular field. He's got many publications to his name. He's planning to publish several more on this topic in the near future. So without further ado, I'll hand over to Kristen, and I'm really looking forward to having you. This is going to be an exciting talk, and I'm very much looking forward. Thank you.
Well, thank you, Christian, for that introduction. It's very kind of you. And I'm very proud and happy to be associated with and working with the International Centre for Policing and Security and working with Christian Cownett and colleagues there. As Christian said, I worked with, I'm never sure whether I worked with or for Airbus group from 2014 through to 2017. It's a background to what I'm going to talk about today. One of the big threats, and we were well aware of it, and it was part of the focus of some of the work I did with them, some of the publication I had during that time, was the threat from Russia. Now, what I didn't cover with them, I think almost at all, was the threat from China. And I will talk about that in sort of second half of the presentation today, once I've talked through the theory, first third, Russia second third, and then into China and issues of hybrid warfare. It's part based though, the part on China at least, on a conversation I had whilst with Airbus Group in Toronto, in the beautiful city of Toronto back in 2016, where it was casually mentioned to me all that China was doing in this, in the field of cyber, writ large, which includes hybridity and hybrid warfare and hybrid security ideas. And even then, it was an eye-opener, and it was one I took on board a few years ago and determined myself to write what I'd learned as much as I could. And I just wanted to write, at the time, one book, which was on cyber warfare. It evolved into two, second being on cyber espionage. They're too large for publishers, so it's likely there are going to be at least three, and potentially I've certainly got enough for four books. We'll see what happens. You can see from the slides there what it's based on, who I talk to, and it represents 7 years of work through to the present. Oops. So some of the key concepts which you'll hear about in the next three quarters of an hour to an hour. Fourth generation warfare, 4GW. Mirror imaging, seeing the other side, your opponent, as you see yourself, which in itself carries dangers and is part of the reason that you have a slide from Lewis Carroll and Through the Looking Glass. It is a theme that we'll look at again at the end. Maskarovka, deception, that too makes an appearance, as does ideas behind a book called Unrestricted Warfare, published in China in 1999. And later we learn more about acupuncture and paralysis warfare, and then into the worrying topic of social psychological war. We'll introduce ourselves a bit more slowly into the Gerasimov doctrine, Russia's active measures campaigns, issues of cyber warfare and cyber espionage, and our big topic, kind of central approach, how this affects and how we look at hybrid warfare. Russia and China are two of the major threats that sit out there in terms of the West. And that's not only Europe and North America, that's Western aligned nations. It includes developing parts of the world and fully developed parts of the world, and how they are drawing plans against us.
Would have believed in the early years of the 21st century that our world was being watched by intelligences greater than our own. That as men busied themselves about their various concerns, they observed and studied. The way a man with a microscope might scrutinize the creatures that swarm and multiply in a drop of water. With infinite complacency, men went to and fro about the globe, confident of our empire over this world. Yet, across the gulf of space, intellects vast and cool and unsympathetic regarded our planet with envious eyes. And slowly and surely drew their plans against us.
It's not quite an invasion from Mars, but we are being studied. We are being scrutinized, and those centers of power are in Shanghai and other places, and Moscow and other places. And they affect everyone every day, both domestically and internationally. So let's step back a little and think, what do we mean by hybrid warfare? It is not a pitched battle of two clearly identified enemies. And in some cases, I don't think we're even talking necessarily about enemies. They're also people just who share different or opposing points of view. It's not necessarily about state-on-state conflict or open war, but also where counterinsurgency campaigns, nationalism and terrorism combine to blur these lines. They form part of the definition of hybrid warfare, and they are a series of activities in that gray zone, a much traveled phrase of hostility below the threshold of conventional warfare. That sees the distinction between combatants and non-combatants and state, non-state and sub-state actors blur. But despite its contemporary re-emergence, hybrid warfare's historical pedigree goes as far back as the Peloponnesian War in the 5th century BC that Thucydides wrote so elegantly about and is still taught in IR departments and in various other disciplines the world over, 2.5 centuries later. Its modern iteration can be perhaps traced to Martin van Creveld back in 91. He was the first to focus on low-intensity warfare, which he saw as the last gasp of large-scale conventional war. And bearing in mind, this was after World War I, World War II, and the 50-year Cold War, and what he called the rise of non-Trinitarian Clausewitzian warfare, and we'll talk about Clausewitz in a while. Perhaps Frank G. Hoffman, a name we'll return to again, was the first Western military scholar to define what others were characterizing at the time as fourth generation warfare. That's where the state and non-state actors utilize means such as terrorism and information to undermine the will of the existing state, to seek to delegitimize it, and to stimulate an internal social breakdown. Now this, as we may see, is certainly in evidence, especially in Russian political interference or influence campaigns. It's not something I had time to go into detail, but I've got two chapters on Russian interference in the UK and US. But as we'll see later, there's a number of other countries they've been involved with, as of other actors. Hoffman saw merit in 4GW, but preferred to style this blurring between combatants, non-combatants, conflict types, and definitions of war and peacetime, as well as use of geography and cyber, as a convergence into multimodal or hybrid wars. The theories underlying them and the subsequent articulation of this within Russia is the Gerasimov Doctrine. As we saw earlier, they're not new inventions. For Russia, the more responsive to counterinsurgency campaigns began in 1979 in Afghanistan through to 88 when they withdrew in the two decade long Caucasus wars and conflicts there. In the Middle East, their experience of international and the international experiences of counterterrorism operations, partly that sprung out of the results of these conflicts and also arrived as a result of the 2011 Arab Spring. Now, using this lens helps illuminate Russia's take on hybrid war, and in particular, how their views and attitudes were affected by the two decades long Chechen wars, and before that, Afghanistan. However, although coin have been featured a conflict throughout recorded history, what's different about this reemergence is the cyber context. This is something I absolutely believe. I remember giving a talk at, I think, Kinetic, the defense contractor up in the West Country a few years ago, and I was asked then what the difference is between the things I was talking about and things like electronic warfare, which they were very familiar with and very interested in. And I struggled with the question. And because I struggled with it, I thought about it and looked at it. And this is my answer. The reach and speed of cyber and how this works at pace provides combatants and non-combatants and state and non or sub-state actors a reach into geographically distant states and societies, all of which are connected nationally and globally through the internet and increasingly through the use of 4 and then into what will become 5G mobile networks. That has no historical parallel. And whether at the state on state or the non or sub-state level, unconventional, regular and irregular threats are offering asymmetrical challenges to classification orthodoxy, which has dominated our thinking about the concept of war itself and the conduct and its character and Clausewitz's trinity. Cyber does have its limitations though. What it cannot do is to take and hold territory. That's really the realm of hard military power, of boots on the ground, of air power, space assets, navies, missiles. But what it can do is degrade, damage, or weaken the state in a matter of hours and days or over time. As part of a campaign, and this could be much like a million pinprick attacks or the analogy of a frog boiling in water that doesn't notice it's boiling until it's too late to jump out. It could also currently be accomplished by persistent barrage. And that barrage is hourly, daily, minutely aimed at industrial, economic, and political targets. Part of the work I did with Airbus and what will still be one book is aimed solely at critical infrastructure, oil, gas, water, everything that a developed society needs to function. And as we've seen during the pandemic, if things like food production starts tilting at the edges, people start to panic and society starts to little, if I put it that way. Far end of the scale, you're into something called social breakdown, which I know well from other work in the nuclear weapons field. That is a danger for societies in general, particularly liberal democratic societies. What that barrage could do, what that million pinbricks could do, could, maybe will, or would, enable an opponent to use a metaphor from Sun Tzu to subdue the enemy without fighting. And within Clausewitz's trinity of violence, chance, and probability, with war seen as a political action, lies what he felt was the tendency to escalate and to rouse passions. And that leads to previous constraints being removed. That has a direct implication for the law of armed conflict and the law of war. It also has clear dimensions for cyber war and hybrid conflicts. To focus in on Russia for a bit, and the Gerasimov Doctrine. According to Mark Galeotti, who, alongside Keir Giles and a few others, are currently on a Channel 5 series on, I think, Sunday evening, talking about modern Russia. I encourage you to watch it. According to Galeotti, Russia's reached back and relearned a particular Soviet lesson that political effects are what matters, not the means to achieve them. So instead of trying to contest NATO at its strongest on the battlefield, and it's worth remembering that NATO's combined defense budget of $946 billion to Russia's $47.4 billion. It is instead an example of asymmetric warfare which uses gamesmanship, corruption, disinformation instead of direct force. Now, for me and for others, this helps set Russian dis- and misinformation campaigns. Election interference and even state sanctions take control of large-scale cybercrime into context. Additionally, though, it's also a part of a mass provoker, that tactic of deception to mask, disguise, or camouflage, which both Sun Tzu and Clausewitz well understood, and are designed to serve political and military ends. It was noted, particularly back in 2014, when the Crimea crisis happened, and it looked like the potential for escalation was there. And I was at a subset of NATO's main meeting back in 2014, which is held in the Celtic Manor, where I asked the Deputy Secretary General what the red lines are, and it produced a very difficult answer of, we don't know, we don't talk about red lines. And in that situation, where Russian troops moved into Ukraine, they stripped away their insignia and instead became little green men and irregular forces trying to blend in. And that removal of insignia matters, as does identifying a clear and defined combatant stroke enemy. Now, with that in the background and in mind, the West finds itself in a new, the terminology varies, whether it's a gray area or hot piece, and whether we see Russia as an irritant or challenge or as an outright threat, one that is unlikely to materialize in material form, we hope. Rather, it's a combine of covert, indirect, and political operations, typically conducted, controlled, or facilitated by the numerous Russian intelligence security agencies, which strike from every cyber group, driven by a single intent. And that intent is to enhance Russia's standing, restore it to be a great power to be taken equally after the effects of the end of the Cold War and its collapse in the 1990s, and now its reorganization and revival under Putin. It matters. Sun Tzu wrote in The Art of War millennia ago that if sovereign and subject are in accord, put division between them. Attack where he's unprepared, appear where you are not expected. That maxim is no more evident than in Britain's 2016 Brexit referendum and the 2016 US presidential elections, two narrow victories for sides Russia supported actively through active measures campaigns. This is a design, this is a plan. This is being studied and scrutinized. Putin returned to power he has returned to power, but he gained power from President Yeltsin in 2000, and election interference operations began 4 years later. Since then, at least 27 nations have been targets in ongoing active measures campaigns of various different intensities. This includes false reporting on people and events, which heightened it into their echo chambers. That sees like-minded views reinforced. It's led to that delightful term fake news, and it's used to pour scorn over traditional television and print mainstream media reporting. If you saw during, before, and after the Capitol riots back in January, you would have seen all that evidenced. It's part of the Russian playbook. And it's also being leveraged by domestic political parties as part of wider trends first pioneered by spin doctors and government advisors for political and actually electioneering purposes. And before that, it goes back to advertising in the turn of the century, turn of the 19th into the 20th centuries. For Russia, this is aided and abetted by agents of influence, cultivated inside foundations, think tanks, companies, within organizations and through individuals who share, not in all cases, and it might be agents of convenience or useful idiots, as they're termed, but some may share a similar or related national or world view. Some, like Jacob Chansley, might not know it. This is a return essentially to Soviet era policies and methods. We're now in the third decade since the Soviet Union collapsed, and no Cold War, at least as we understood it then. And in those three decades, the KGB successors, the FSB, SVR and GRU, Russian Military Intelligence, FSB Foreign, SVR mixture. They've again become well-resourced agencies with a renewed focus. Where that renewed focus has come from, I've talked about a little, I'll talk about more. But they're also competitors as well as putatively, collaborators. This has seen the GRU and FSB in brutal competition. Both the FSB and SVR are at least as potent and combative as the GRU. Their leaderships are, like Vladimir Putin himself, Siloviki, Russian for strong men or men of power, men of strength. Big men who pose in Russian rivers in freezing cold or the bear or the tiger to show their strength. These men, and they are almost invariably men, covet domestic power and international influence. As Gagliotti asserts, the security community in Russia is characterized by division, duplication, and deep institutional rivalry. They're essentially set to compete amongst themselves for power, prestige. Their successes are lauded, their failures catastrophic. It is within this competing domestic context that the American cybersecurity firm CrowdStrike identified the lack of deconfliction in the hack and leak operations during the presidential election of 2016 between Fancy Bear, APT-28, Advanced Persistent Threat 28, run by Russia's military intelligence, the GRU, and the FSB's Cozy Bear unit, APT-29. What is consistent is that the Kremlin and Putin personally deny everything. The look over their defense, the nothing happening, nothing to see here, look over their defense. Using that tactic of mass provoca. Even despite when the strongest evidence of Russian state involvement is presented. Between which they leverage the criminal underworld, which includes targeted killings, using cyber criminals and cyber crime networks as proxies, granting them a privateer status. So long as you don't harm the motherland, you can do anything you like elsewhere, and you will be protected. No extradition treaty, just don't leave Russia if you don't want to be arrested. And if you want to check out any of this, look on the FBI's most wanted cyber crime list. it's used as a foreign policy tool. These tactics are used as foreign policy tools, part of their toolbox and part of their hybrid warfare doctrine. It's an arena where inconvenience and discomfort can be created for governments, societies, and economies, but without escalating the consequences across a very distinct threshold that qualifies as the use of force or armed conflict. And that is legalized under the UN Charter. It is subject of active discussion within NATO at NATO SICON conferences and in the Tallinn manuals. I said a talk about the Gerasimov Doctrine. Its name is drawn from General Valery Gerasimov on the publication of a document back in February 2014 on a speech that was given, which discussed the adoption of a clear set of doctrinal principles for non-military means of achieving political and strategic goals, which has grown in many cases and exceeded the power of force or weapons in their effectiveness. That's the Gerasimov Doctrine in a nutshell, but it's controversial. For Galeotti, it doesn't exist. And he's probably right enough to say it because, to his immense chagrin, he created the term, which has since required a destructive life of its own, lumbering clumsily into the world to spread fear and loathing in its wake. Instead, he argues, and many, many agree, there is no single Russian doctrine. That said, Gerasimov does help illuminate and does help explain things. And it's a useful shorthand for Russian activities. But this partly points to the nature of the competition within Russia and the elevation of certain figures, like Gerasimov, because it's part of a long train of thought, beginning with Defense Minister Anatoly Sergeyev, but especially Chief of the General Staff Nikolai Makarov, both of whom fell from grace back in 2012, which led to the appointment of Gerasimov. In addition, three others are worthy of mention. Their pictures are all there on the right-hand side. First is Igor Khabarov. He was a career intelligence officer and graduate of the GRU's Conservatory, appointed in 2016 as Director of Military Intelligence Directorate. He, like a number of other senior Russian military figures, died fairly well before their time, back in 2018. Second is Sergei Shoigu, Minister of Defense, appointed in 2012. Third, Pyotr Vashutin. He is credited with establishing the GRU's empire from its headquarters, the Aquarium. He spent his career throughout the Soviet period into the KGB, leading military intelligence from the early 60s through to his death in 2002. Putin would have known him and known him well. They're part of Russia's intelligence community. It's designed to mislead, to confuse, distract, and interfere. It's partly built on four Ds: dismiss, distort, distract, and dismay. And that's part of an approach to information war, warfare. What Gerasimov really doesn't explain is why Russia is interested in pre-positioning and holding Western critical infrastructure at risk, and especially in the US. But this is an area where China is even more advanced. But all of these are active measures used by Russia's intelligence agencies. And that idea of holding key targets at risk, like critical infrastructure, but also potentially like societies themselves, is an element of modern military strategy and intelligence and the intelligence picture. The idea being that in the event of hostilities or other contingencies, One has the ability to destroy or disable key targets. This can be done either as a means to denying of denying an adversary the capacity for action, or of imposing costs upon an adversary. To the far end of the scale would be unacceptable costs. That fits with Russian and Chinese activities in critical infrastructure, which are more than just cyber attacks or cyber espionage. And instead of which, my fear is that potentially part of a sustained long-term strategy to pre-position and hold key sectors such as the electrical grid at risk. That fits within the framework that Galeotti disagrees exists, enunciated in the Gerasimov Doctrine, and is also held within Chinese strategy. That said, the Gerasimov Doctrine is more concerned with regime change. That includes domestically and fear of regime change at home. We've seen it very recently with Alexei Navalny's poisoning and incarceration in Siberia. Not for the first time a Russian dissident has been put in the gulag. That focus draws on the color revolutions in Eastern Europe, both during the Cold War transition period and into the 1990s. The Arab Spring of 2011, Ukraine's main revolt, which led to the exile of the then pro-Russian president. The thinking in the Kremlin is those were events orchestrated in Washington, or more specifically in Langley, CIA headquarters. Russia's conception suite, like China's, is different. That's why I was talking about mirror imaging at the start. See others as we see ourselves. That's a danger. It's known in the intelligence community that imparting the views of what we would do in those circumstances, or if we were looking through their eyes, is a sort of cultural approximation. Russia, like China, doesn't even use necessarily the same words, or those words may not carry the same meaning. They heavily use the word instead, informationization, rather than kyber, or cyber warfare, kybernoiva. I do apologize for my Russian pronunciation, by the way. I'm not even going to attempt Mandarin Chinese, of which I have a little of later. That term instead embraces, as a more holistic concept, computer network operations, electronic warfare, psychological operations, and information operations. Cyber is the mechanism, is the transport mechanism to achieving an end. To look to dominate the information landscape, seen as a warfare domain in its own right, and ideally to be employed as part of a whole of government effort. This is where non and sub-state actors and criminals and cyber criminals come into play. And that can be used alongside more traditional weapons of information warfare that would be familiar to any student of Russian or Soviet military doctrine, included disinformation operations, psychological operations, electronic warfare, and political subversion. It also plays a part in suppressing domestic opposition. It's seen Russia conduct operations against all three of the Baltic states, against Georgia, and most successfully against Ukraine. We saw Crimea annexed back in 2014. It's also seen Russia stand accused by the US intelligence community and others of direct and sustained influence in the 2016 US presidential elections. Russia also stands accused of attempting to influence the various French and German national elections and others across Europe, including Greece's potential exit from the EU when it was suffering from severe economic troubles back in around 2014, as well as the aforementioned Brexit vote in the UK and in a large number of the target states, like I said, up to 27, if not more. That all fits within the design of Gerasimov, of that weakening the EU is likely to benefit Russia and indirectly dilute NATO's effectiveness, divide and rule. I could only cover a small selection of Russia's cyber espionage campaigns. I've only got two slides worth, and none of them are detailed. They are advanced, persistent, and they are threats. Beginning with Moonlight Maze, pre-Putin, mid-1990s operation. Red October, described by the Russian cybersecurity firm Kaspersky as an elusive cyber espionage campaign targeting diplomatic, governmental, scientific research organizations in several countries. But its focus was on targets in Eastern Europe and countries in Central Asia, most if not all of which were former Soviet satellite nations, but also spread out to Western Europe and into North America. Dragonfly and the Dragonfly campaign. That's a campaign of malware attacks which began around 2010. Initially, it targeted aviation and defense companies in the US and Canada before migrating into the energy sector early in 2013. The energy sector being hugely important to the Russian economy and to Russian oligarchs. That was reported to have infected more than 1,000 energy companies in North America and Europe, and between 2,500 and 2,800 in total. It's also been found in other industries, such as pharmaceuticals, as well as academia, looking for gateway and persistent access into facilities. This is common. It was resuscitated in December 2015 as Dragonfly 2.0. Beginning with fake news Eve invitations, we targeted over 100 companies across Europe, all the way from Ireland on its west to Turkey in the southeast, as well as in the United States. This hit government facilities and multiple critical infrastructure sites, including energy, nuclear, water, aviation, as well as critical manufacturing sectors, as well as commercial facilities. As much as anything, it serves as a test. TV Saint-Mont in France was attacked in April 2015. That too is seen as a test. Test of NATO's and France's national responsiveness. More seriously, perhaps, and I do emphasize perhaps, depending on how you look at these things. In December 15, 2015, was subjected to a cyber attack which tested its responses. It had been attacked on and off for the previous 5 years, if not before, alongside other forms of cyber disruption and espionage, which all of which amounted to a steady drumbeat of cyber attacks targeting Ukraine's government, military, telecommunications, and private sector IT infrastructure. But they followed a step change in 2015-16. And two critical points in the year, winter, in December, around Christmas time, which shut the power off in various parts of Ukraine in 2015 and only in the capital, Kiev, in 2016. Ukraine became the first nation to experienced a cyber attack which took down part of its power grid through malware known as Black Energy. Black Energy has evolved into a campaign that has now spanned almost a decade. Again, depending on your point of view, perhaps even more serious is Project Lacta. This is the code name for Russia's active measures campaign that promoted Donald Trump over Hillary Clinton in the 2016 US presidential election, which included, amongst other things, strategized propaganda and dis and misinformation campaigns, efforts of destabilization and efforts towards election interference, direct election interference, I should add, which included the tabulation of votes, and is partly the reason why the 2020 US presidential election was so controversial, at least in some eyes, and why there were such stringent measures put in place to guard its security. To go back to a derivative of black energy, industrial or crash override, that was even more advanced than the general purpose tools used against Ukraine back in 2015. That could be precisely targeted and was against Ukraine, but with a small amount of tailoring, can also be effective against the North American grid. Take a step back again. What do we think hybrid warfare amounts to? Does the Gerasimov doctrine accurately represent, in broad outline, Russia's goals, Russia's policies? For Michael Kaufman, another Russia watcher, hybrid warfare has instead become the Frankenstein in the field of Russian military analysis, which has taken on a life of its own, of which there is no way to contain it. Clouding this picture is how they've used proxies, how they've used the look over their defense. It wasn't us, we didn't do it. The way they've not so much hacked, because when they've hacked institutions, including the Democratic National Committee in the US, computer forensics tells us date stamps, times, Cyrillic alphabets, time zones, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. It's a fire to the smoke. But the use of third-party news outlets, including leaking to WikiLeaks, and using other third-party forces, perhaps like the QAnon movement, again, either wittingly or unwittingly, that adds to the smoke and a layer of anonymity, which potentially camouflages the source of information and conceals motivations of why information is being released and how it's percolated and buoyed within the social media ecosystem. All of which designed to obscure realities or confuse the target. Focusing a little on the GRU, Russia's military intelligence arm. They are home to unit 26165. That alone stands accused of hacking the World Anti-Doping Authority. If you remember, Russia's been embroiled in doping scandals. It's not alone, but embroiled in doping scandals for the best part of 20 years, if not well before into Soviet times. It's suspected of being in existence since the 1970s, dealing then with cryptography run by the GRU's Sixth Directorate, which includes running listening posts, encrypting messages, and attempting to decrypt enemy communications. Its main base, as I alluded to earlier, is called the Conservatory. That's the name given to the Defense Ministry's Military Academy in Moscow. Training there lasts for 3 years. And like all the major intelligence schools, trainees are vetted, subject to rigorous testing, and includes areas such as language and facial recognition. It has three departments. It operates under official cover status, which aided them in the OPCW case and aids them in installing long-term agents under deep cover. It involves foreign recruitment. The second department trains military attaches who operate under embassies and work at diplomatic missions or serve as members of the armed forces. Two of whom were exposed in the attempted 2016 coup in Montenegro, who was attempting then to join NATO. The third department is dedicated to instructing officers for foreign special operations. Division 12B is dedicated to information war. The GRU is headquartered in the aquarium, which is ringed by research institutes affiliated to the intelligence services. This is physical. Which represents nearly a fifth of the world's population and which is the sum of its parts. Western military theorizing regarding the nature of scope of operations in peacetime well ceased to survive first engagements in a hot war scenario. That applies to Chinese theory and danger of mirror imaging as it does to Russia's Gerasimov doctrine. Like Russia, China's a nuclear weapon state, but it has the world's largest standing army, the second largest defense budget, which is expected to exceed that of the United States by mid-century, if not before. It's thoroughly modernizing its military. Its military is the PLA, the People's Liberation Army. The PLA is directly responsible to the Communist Party, not to the Chinese state. In terms of the activities of the PLA and its intelligence wings, in particular, aircraft designs have been an especially lucrative target, especially those from US defense contractors. And since 2012, China's been ruled by Xi Jinping. Its cyber campaigns include that's linked as well to Russia, to China's economic drive and outward looking through the Belt and Road Initiative, which is massive in scope. Individual groups include Common Crew or APT-1, designated by Vanguard and operating within the PLA's unit 61398 in Shanghai. That's been active since around 2006, and it's conducted around 140 separate attacks, including companies involved in critical infrastructure in the United States, including the power grid, gas lines, and waterworks. Operation Aurora, that was discovered in early January 2010, and then made public by Google. And Google is one of a host of firms attacked. Shady Rat. Another global operation active from the mid to late 2000s. The Office of Personnel Management, the OPM breach between 2013 and 2015, only discovered after the NSA had gone into this government system by CrowdStrike, who were employed as a third party contractor. That shows how good Chinese cyber espionage is. This, not to mention the really interesting case of DGI Science and Technology in the US and the sale of wind farm technology to Sinovel in the Gobi Desert. Hawaiian Core telecommunications infrastructure, and the controversy has been engendered by them, as it has by ZTE Corporation. The controversy surrounding civil nuclear power and 5G rollout in the UK, and again, the involvement of Huawei. Or firmware and chip level vulnerabilities, including vulnerabilities, Spectre and Meltdown. China, like Russia, has underlying theories. And frankly, they've been at it a long time again, and they're very, very, very good. And they learn quickly and well. Articles in information warfare and the theories around it first started to appear back in the early 1990s, after the first Gulf War. They were then inserted into field exercises. They follow the US model closely of how to fight in high-tech battlefield conditions. And this is how they saw information warfare. It's not at that time or since cyber warfare, but through to the late 1990s, the Chinese variant instead of network-centric warfare, a system of systems approach, satellites, long-range capabilities, deep strike missions, satellite reconnaissance, intelligence and surveillance capabilities. Now its structure, excuse me, it's just product talking too long, I'm afraid. Its structure looks approximately like this, or something like this. China's, the People's Republic of China, like I said, is run by the Communist Party of China, whose military win and close integration is with the People's Liberation Army. The structure of the PLA's second department now operates the Intelligence Bureau of the Joint Staff Department. It's responsible for human intelligence collection. It oversees the work of defense attaches operating out of Chinese embassies and other clandestine activities. Three PLA control signals intelligence. Four PLA is responsible for electronic intelligence and offensive electronic warfare, but both now have probably been subsumed into something called the Strategic Support Force.
Kris, you're muted.
I know, it kicked me out. Can you see my can you see my slides?
No, we don't.
And now?
Also, if you're not recording anymore, if you press record again.
Okay. Sorry, I'm also going on longer than I thought. No, I am still recording, I think. Sorry. I'll now try and speed up anyway.
Kris, we don't see the presentation as well.
Okay, all right. Sorry, this is a hazard of trying to do this thing through Zoom. I'm doing it remotely. More. Share screen. Screen through. Share. Back?
Yes, great.
Cool. Right, I'm going to cycle through to slide 24, however, is that? I would be glad of the day I can do this in a room again, full of people. Right, let's go to 3PLA. Prior to the 2015 reorganization, the third department could have been home to as many as, and get an idea of this number, 130,000 linguists, engineers, technicians, analysts, and researchers, as well as having access to several dozen ground stations capable of long-range collection, specially instrumented ships, tactical mobile ground systems, and airborne platforms. This is all used for their Air Force, Navy, and Second Artillery Force. They are the sort of branches of the PLA. And each is assigned at least one technical reconnaissance bureau, which are massive in and of themselves, the TRBs. They're subordinate to the Third Department. They took monitor foreign communications and cyber activity. That's broken down into seven military regions and several major cities. That, in turn, is likely to lead to different regional differences in approach and analysis. This is what we think we know, that the GSD 4th Department was mainly responsible for computer network attack. This is the idea of mirror imaging, though these are American military terms, and planning during peacetime. Mulvanen adds in a widely quoted chapter, during wartime, this structure strongly suggests that personnel from the GSD 4th Department will be the trigger pullers at both national and war zone level. There were two excellent reports, one in 2009, one in 2012 by Northrop Grumman. That suggests that the 4th Department had responsibility for offensive cyber operations. Another key writer on this, Larry Wurzel, speculated, given the 3rd Department's analytical and language capabilities, its personnel probably analyzed and exploit the cyber information gathered by the 4th Department's offensive actions. That structure was consolidated in 2002 after a hard-won and prolonged bureaucratic struggle, with a really key figure in Chinese hybrid warfare, cyber espionage campaigns, Major General Dai Quimin, after he assumed control of the organization and really put forward his ideas of INU, integrated network and amplified warfare. To give you an idea of the scale of the TRBs, the Technical Reconnaissance Bureaus, there's a very good analysis done by Project 2049, which is based in Arlington in Virginia. And they said, PLA SIGINT community consists of at least 28 TRBs. The GSD's 3rd Department, the General Staff's Department, and the 3rd Department of that General Staff is often referred to as 3PLA, is roughly analogous to the US National Security Agency. That has direct authority over the 12 operational bureaus, 3 research institutes, and a computing center. 8 of the 12 operational bureau headquarters are clustered in Beijing. 2 are based in Shanghai, 1 in Chengdu, 1 in Wuhan. 10 additional TRBs provide direct support to PLA 7 military regions. Another 6 support the plan, PLA Navy, the Air Force, and the 2nd Artillery Force. That second bureau, unit 61398, is one of the largest amongst the 12. It's been in operation since at least 2006 and is considered to be one of the most prolific cyber espionage groups, both in terms of the sheer quantity of the information stole it, and frankly, the quality of it, and what it's been able to do with it. But it's one of more than 20 APT groups with origins in China. That's it. It's moved, that's become its permanent home on the Tong Road in the Pudong New area of Shanghai. 12 stories high. Attributed by Mandiant under its military unit covenant designation as unit 61398. Now, it's usual for cybersecurity firms not to attribute, but they did in this case. With Kevin Mandia, their CEO, feeling by going public, they can induce the Chinese to change their behaviors. But first, we're giving them a Mike Tyson uppercut. It's been investigated a little, and I do mean a little, by various news agencies, and I've got to make sure that I'm sharing sound again. Because I've got a very short video for you.
This building is the focus of a report from U.S. Cybersecurity firm Mandiant. They say a hacking collective with direct ties to the Chinese military has stolen data from 141 organizations from around the world since 2006. A CNN crew tried to roll their cameras through that neighborhood. And this is what they discovered. This is our crew being chased by Chinese security officers.
Chase after us just yet.
Keep driving away. CNN's David McKenzie is live for us in Shanghai with more. Walk me through exactly what happened as you tried to get access to that building.
Well, Soledad, you know, the security officers did say that, we shouldn't be filming there. They said it was a military installation of some kind. And as we got closer with the camera and drove past, they outran the vehicle and had a relatively cordial chat and then demanded some footage, and then we were on our way. But the bigger picture here, Soledad, really, is what is happening here? Shanghai, a major city in China, is the epicenter, says Mandiant, that Virginia-based security company, of a major hacking ring. Tens, if not hundreds, of hackers working in those buildings, they say, attacking corporations, institutions, governments, particularly in the U.S., and stealing terabytes of information. The Mandiant group says that this group is working in conjunction with the Chinese military and the Chinese government. Chinese government, not surprisingly, Soledad, says that they have nothing to do with this. They call these claims, quote, irresponsible. The Chinese military saying they also have nothing to do with the hackers. Is this just the next salvo in an information war, Soledad? We're going to have to watch this very closely.
We're watching it very closely. CNN's David McKenzie watching it for us. Thanks, David. Appreciate it.
Like I said, they drew lessons through the 1991 Gulf War and into the 1990s. But in 1999, there's something of a step change with the publication of the widely read treatise, Unrestricted Warfare, authored by two Chinese colonels. That foresaw the boundaries between the two worlds of war and non-war, of military and non-military, will be totally destroyed. It also forecast a shift towards atypical forms of war through a relative decline in military violence, but increases in political, economic, and technological violence. It deliberately invoked Clausewitz, with Kuan Wang stating at the outset, if we acknowledge that new principles of war are no longer using armed force to compel the enemy to submit to one's will, but instead are built upon using all means, including armed force and non-armed force, military and non-military, and lethal and non-lethal means to compel the enemy to accept one's interests, is what they termed unrestricted warfare. By contrast, Frank Hoffman's work on hybrid warfare, capturing many of the same ideas, appeared in the West almost a decade later. It meant combining Schwarzkopf, Norman Schwarzkopf, commander in the first Gulf War, plus George Soros, that philanthropist and beloved of the right wing, plus bin Laden, terrorist type tactics, who also believed the war with the US was inevitable, hence the subtitle that he was used by Western publishers, China's Master Plan to Destroy America. That's something called Thucydides' Trap. And in their view, unrestricted warfare encompassed stock market crashes, computer viruses, included rumors or scandalous weapons, the use of hacking and non or sub-state actors, and their use to create trade war, financial war, new types of terror warfare, including ecological, psychological, and smuggling war, using the media, drugs, networks, and technological war, along with, if necessary, fabricated research, culture, and international law warfare. Lawfare, that is a completely separate topic, but lawfare is an issue in and of itself. Unrestricted warfare was years ahead of its time. And there's little doubt, based on both empirical evidence of cyber reconnaissance, cyber espionage, and cyber attacks, as well as follow-on discussions in the PLA, that these were principles that were taken up, and they were taken up both by China and by Russia. And furthermore, they work. That's the worrying thing. That's the thing to be alive to. They work. But at the time, they were conceived of in an environment where we had dial-up modems. And the internet was not what it is today. The world of social media was yet to be invented. Instead, concepts like NCW, Network Center for Warfare and Informational Warfare, were in vogue. Even at the time, it was controversial. Both PLA officials and Chinese lawyers both criticized for violating several principles of just war theory. Both Kuo and Wang were subjected to some official criticism by the academy, the much heralded Academy of Military Sciences, as well as the Ministry of Foreign Affairs back in 2000. Its Machiavellianism was also criticized in Hong Kong as promoting guidelines to remove ethical principles for the PLA. That said, it was widely read within the Chinese Communist Party and within the PLA. Within 2 years, it had sold 70,000 copies and had been reprinted 7 times. Kuo had personally been approached by 120 generals. It is strategically innovative. But that said, as I pointed to in the first couple of slides, there were strategic antecedents. It involves ideas of acupuncture or paralysis warfare. That includes, as a branch of information warfare, all types of warfighting activities involve the exploitation, alteration, or paralysis of the enemy's information systems, as well as all those activities that involve protecting one's own information and information systems from exploitation, alteration, and paralysis by the enemy. This really is anticipating, for example, the Snowden revelations and the NSA disclosure from 2013. The late 1990s, also information warfare discussions, talk about Sun Tzu's maxims from the art of war and a focus upon subduing the enemy without battle or without fighting, and ideas of Xi, which has multiple meanings, but it's at its heart contains ideas of superiority or advantage. China's thinking long term. These ideas are now 20 years old. They've been thinking about psychological warfare, psyops, what unrestricted warfare means, what preparation of the battle space means, what preemption means, the potential for hiding self-destructing microchips and systems destined for export. targeting military, financial, telecommunications, electronic power systems, and other infrastructure to use strategic deception. It includes ideas of social psychological war. And another key Chinese thinker, Shen, seeing communication channels open up between different classes and social groups and seeing these multiply, the effects of globalization, the globalization of media sources and the breaking down of them. Trying to set stages for propaganda war and a battle for public opinion. And think of this quote. If, just as an example, we look back to the Capitol riots of January, Shen saw the use of shaping public opinion in the following terms. Culture is the glue for society and the foundation for social stability. It sets social norms and defines and shapes every social system. Cultural confusion will ultimately affect the security of a nation's social strata. China also views this domestically or through a domestic lens, like Russia does with Gerasimov. It too looks at wider events like the 2011 Arab Spring, which toppled regimes across North Africa and spread to Saudi Arabia before stopping. And then in Syria, which has led to civil war and the tragedy that's befallen the region. In China, which liberalized after Tiananmen Square, after the Tiananmen Square protests in 1989, it too saw the Jasmine Revolution of February 2011, which again is a sort of mechanism lever for alleviating public discontent through a form of democratic reforms, if I put it to you in that Western context. Timothy Thomas is one of those who've been able, through Americans' military academies and their access to Chinese sources, to look back at Chinese thinking. And he attests the 95 to 2000 period represented 5 years of learning and advancement for the Chinese military. They learned from what the first Gulf War, from the Kosovo campaign in 1999, from the wars in former Yugoslavia, and then into the second Gulf War of 2003. We see it evidenced in the science and military strategy, which China produces every 5 to 10 years. And the work of key thinkers like General Dai Quiming. It's also a signpost for the evolution of Central Committee thinking of what the West views as cyber warfare, part of which revolves around protecting your own information assets, without which, in a shooting, well, in a non-cyber or cyber-enabled shooting war, or cyber shooting war, that instantly can become a zero-sum game and a losing situation. Other ideas are in play as well, like network psychological war, which another key thinker, Dai, believed, whose power comes from the internet's trait of being interactive, open, timely, widespread, diversified, and influential, where people's recognition systems are the target, and where media misrepresents their environment, and where it is very difficult for humans to test or verify it. When I hear and see and read about fake news, I think about China, not about Russia. I think about Russia in terms of what they've learned from China, and I'll talk about that towards the end in a couple of minutes. For thinkers like Dai, NPW cuts across national borders can be used both in peacetime and in war, used to affect politics, economics, culture, and militaries. It involves the use of propaganda, intimidation, deception, enticement, bribery, as well as deterrence. When Dai was writing, websites were the ideal medium for dissemination. Now it's social media and the social media ecosystem. Like I said, in my very last point there, you placed the word social at the beginning of that. Social network, psychological war, and suddenly produces new meaning. Because that world has moved on into Facebook, Instagram, WhatsApp. WhatsApp. That has virally increased the capacity for dissemination. It has allowed the spread of both mis and disinformation, and with it, false ideas gain traction, and where the echo chamber effect is in full voice, and where like-minded views are reinforced and can and are rapidly entrenched. China has been very successful in various platforms. I mean, that is a former Russian carrier which sold to China under license to be used as a floating casino in Macau. In actuality, a training base for power projection and China's burgeoning carrier fleet. What it's next going to be looking at, very likely, nuclear propulsion systems, because it's already gone after aviation and successfully repurposed it and reverse engineered it into designs like the J-20 Mighty Dragon in the middle there, and the Xi'an Y-20 heavy lift vehicle, both of which used aviation, avionics materials stolen from the West, and in particular from major US aviation companies. It's being used to shorten the pathways to development. And it's important to China to rocket launch its massive Belt and Road Initiative, which is proceeding apace, while cyber and espionage is used for to hack those who are negotiating on behalf of foreign governments where China is looking to make treaties. So it has big advantages going into negotiations. It has a policy called Made in China 2025. Which aims to produce more indigenous products. But the scale and the ongoing cyber espionage campaigns lead to my conclusion that they're still learning to innovate. That, I think, by China's own admission, and it's not right to generalize, and I tend not to, but China, for a number of years, has been less good at innovation. Very good at replication, less good at innovation, where America really excels. Moreover, China can conduct cyber espionage on a scale that no other nation can currently match. And in the future, artificial intelligence and quantum computing capabilities are going to factor and come into play far more than they do now. How that will evolve, I don't know. In my last two slides, I just want to talk about Sino-Russian dialogues. Because for me, it seems apparent that in Russian intelligence and military circles, they've incorporated elements of Chinese thinking. And Russia's playbook post-Kerasimov Kerasimov Doctrine's founding in 2013, and its operationalness in Russian political and election interference campaigns, ideas of social psychological war. The People's Republic and China of China and Russia have been in bilateral dialogues on these issues since around 2009. Centered on two mechanisms or means. One is the International Forum for Information Security, which is held in Garmisch in Germany, but also subset of meetings as part of the Valdai group. There are others, and there are going to be lots of bilateral meetings too, including the G7, G20 forums and offshoots. In these forums, information warfare and deterrence was discussed in 2011, 2010 and 2011. And there's been treaty dialogue between them. And the topics have included legal provisions to regulate information behavior, defining source of cyber attacks, development of international information security glossary, and content monitoring and filtering, something both Russia and China have in common. They've also got dialogues with the Shanghai Cooperation Organization, the SCO. In those discussions, of the 10 topics presented to Russia's presented, for Russia, escalation models and critical infrastructure were the top two. For China, industrial espionage was top of that list. For Russia, it was at the bottom. It's an interesting juxtaposition. I'm at the end of my presentation. Thank goodness I hear you say. I'm returning to my theme of Alice in Wonderland. It is bewildering. Where are we? What road do I take? Where do you go? Because if you don't know where you're going, any road will get you there. Thank you for your time, your attention, and I will happily answer any questions you may have.
Perfect. Thank you. Thank you very much for this wonderful presentation. I think you've really shown us, you know, almost three of the four books in the presentation. I think there's just so much knowledge there. It's very, very impressive. I mean, let me just come to some of the questions. Mike Edwards asked two questions, so I'll read them to you. And one is, how has hybrid warfare shaped EU policy responses to countering violent extremism in the UK and Europe? And he has a second question, if you want me to read that as well. Do you see a connection between hybrid warfare, threats posed by Russia and China with the ongoing RW and Islamist extremist growth and subsequent threats in the UK and Europe? I just take those two together, and then Ethem has just posted up.
Yeah, they link questions. I mean, the UK's gone for the prevent strategy. And whether it sees terrorism, and I think it probably does see it more as a distinct layer of threat than it does. I mean, there are elements to foreign radicalization attached to it, and to the prevent strategy and the contest strategy. But I think they see it as fairly distinct and hybrid, really, a hybridity. And the sort of the way ideas are circulated and percolated by and through social media, both by genuine believers and by states looking to destabilize Western nations like the UK. I think that's not been, to my eyes, correctly stitched in to that strategy. That would be my short take on it. But I don't know whether or not, Mike, you asked the question whether or not you'd like to add to that at all.
Yeah, thank you, Chris. I thought first and foremost, thank you for your presentation. It was very, very interesting. I'm currently putting a research project together looking at how hybrid warfare has shaped EU policy response to countering violent extremism. Some of the work that I formerly did was around cyber capabilities, the use of social media campaigns by both right-wing organisations and groups, and also by Islamist groups as well, like ISIS and so on. And what I found particularly interesting was the use of bots to really explode or disseminate information that was quite often either misinformation or disinformation around terrorist attacks. So one of the ones that I can draw inference from there really was the one where we, back in London in 2017, we had the London Bridge terror attack. And it was the information about a Muslim female walking past the dead and the wounded on London Bridge, and she was on her mobile phone. And the information that went out as a result of that, and the kind of the connotations around her ethnicity, her religion, and the fact that, you know, the implying then that she didn't care about what was going on, that just went viral across the internet. But then it was found to be a bot that was manufactured to push that information out and to create that sense of dis or misinformation. And I just wonder, you know, with the proxy wars that have happened fairly recently in places like Syria, and the world then at war in certain locations where we do have that extremist radicalization then, which features back into Europe and features back into the UK, whether or not there should be a view to, say, strategists who look at, say, contrast strategy, and you mentioned Prevent there as being one of those, to think a little bit more widely and deeper and as to whether or not countries like Russia and China have a mandate for creating that type of environment where radicalization happens, and then they can just take a step back. So it's almost like radicalization by proxy to target the communities and the society of other countries. They can just step back and say, well, it's nothing to do with us. It's an extremism problem. But actually it is, because it's fueled by them as misinformation and disinformation campaigns.
And I mean, that picture alone, I know the picture you're referring to very well. And that alone is a chisel, which is implanted into the already existing or pre-existing cracks in society, which is designed to wedge them even further open. It would be helpful, I think, to really think about what we talk about but don't do, not only in the UK, but in other nations as well. And it's, you know, we can talk more widely about responses to the pandemic and whether it should be EU-wide or, you know, whether it's done on a national basis and so on. But that talk of a whole of nation response, well, also it should be a community of like-minded nations responding, who see societies, who see, what I'm looking for, multicultural cities and communities, and looking to heal divides, not create them, to bridge gaps between people and not build walls. And whether it's linked to the intelligence picture and whether it should be informed of some of the things I've been discussing today, that's an open question. It's one I would like to see. But I remember sitting, someone I may have mentioned today is Nigel Inkster, former head of SIS, and someone who's talked very elegantly on both Russia and China, has that idea and sees that picture. And I remember sitting next to him in the cabinet office when I did a talk up there, and or did a conversation piece, I should say, and hoping that, you know, that flicker of enthusiasm to look at it holistically, both within as a national government and all the organs of government that spring out of it, but also across the European Union and into North America, I'd like to see more of. I'm not sure that kind of thinking is there yet. We look at it's a sort of quite a segmented way of thinking. Radicalization and counter-radicalization are sort of, they sit there on the sort of periphery of things, rather than being part of a whole of nation or whole of society, a whole of like-minded nations series of responses.
But I suppose then my question to you is do you see then on the work that you've done around hybrid warfare so far, particularly in relation to Russia and China, do you see either of those two countries having a part to play in the extremist threat that has kind of come across Europe and into the UK, whether that be right-wing extremism or Islamist extremism, as a proxy to what they want to achieve?
I think that Russia has operationalized it and China's theorized it. I mean, China's got its own internal sets of issues and pressures, notwithstanding the Uyghur movement in the north, issues of Tibet, China's regions, cohesiveness, the migratory patterns from the countryside into the cities and so on. It's got its internal dynamics happening. at the same time it's stretching it economically through the BRI, but it's a responsible state actor in my eyes, in my view. Russia is a different kettle of fish. Russia, I think, would percolate those ideas if it served its own, well, it's not its own national interest. I don't think its own national interests are being served, but the national interests of its leadership or their perceived interests.
Okay, thank you, Kris. Thank you very much.
Thanks ever so much, Mike.
Great. Ethem wanted to ask a question as well. Ethem, do you want to ask it yourself?
Hi, Kris. I'm just wondering, you know, the Western democracies are giving a little bit dispersed image when it comes to tackling with the hybrid warfare. Is it possible to tackle with Russian and Chinese threat if we consider their organizations are really strictly disciplined and hierarchical organizations? Is it, if it is possible, and how this Western democracies can tackle this problem?
Well, I mean, one thing I'd do anyway is separate out China and Russia. They're not one and the same. And I don't mean that in a flippant sense, because I've just talked about the cooperation between the two of them. But they're as much competitive rivals as they are cooperative actors. Like I said, I see China as very much an opportunity to cooperate. It's coming up to a fifth to a quarter of the world's population. And in issues of climate change and so on, there is a visible need to cooperate. The hierarchy the hierarchy of power is asymmetrical. That's wrong. It's asymmetrical in one sense, it's vertical in another. For example, US social media firms have an inordinate impact globally. Yet and they've domiciled with US laws and US regulations, particularly in California. That they represent 4% of the world's population. There's a disproportionate dynamic going on. I'll think about your question, but would you like to ask it again, just so I can be clear on my own mind?
Or maybe should I ask it in a different way?
Yeah. You know,
there are lots of sanction regimes are implemented against Russia and China.
Yeah.
And is it possible that something can be achieved using these sanctions?
I never thought sanctions are a really good part of the toolkit. I think they work in small measure, but they tend to hit individuals rather than nations. And they tend to hit, even if they were apportioned correctly, sectors rather than national economies. And they hurt the general population. So I'm not a huge fan of sanctions. One of the broader questions, which I think you were alluding to first time around, was liberal democracies are not in the rise globally. They're under challenge by authoritarian regimes and various other regime types. That, when we face with an existential issue like climate change and with global level issues like a pandemic, I think dialogue is so very, very, very important, regardless of regime type. How we go about that, I don't know. And I say I don't know with an eye to the UN and the UN Security Council, which I'd like to see energized and supported more. And things like the Intergovernmental Group on Government Experts, which looks across a range of cyber issues, be properly funded again, be properly internationalized and be properly taken seriously. Because I'm very much in favor of dialogue, of awareness building. Because otherwise, basically what we're gonna do is arms race again. We've arms raced before. Adam, do you wanna come
on? Are they open to dialogue then?
I think Russia is very difficult to persuade. I think they've got a siege mentality which is partly rested on the wealth and power of an existing system.
Mm-hmm.
And they don't want that existing system challenged. It benefits the few, not the many. China, I think, is a very different case and a very different character and very different scale. And I would like to think that China is more open to dialogue and, as I've said earlier, is a globally responsible actor. If you're in the regions and say you're a democracy advocate in Hong Kong, or if you're a Uyghur, or if you're a pro-Tibetan in the pro-Tibetan independence movement, you would see things differently. It's been built.
Thank you, Kris. Thank you.
Thanks so much.
Right, I think we'll take the last question now. There's two questions. Well, maybe if you can give a very short and succinct answer to both of them, I'll take both of them, but otherwise we might be running out of time. So there's a question from Tarun. Can you comment on the role of transparency in countering Russian and Chinese hybrid threats? So this is in relation to the UK's proposal to establish a foreign agent register at par with the US Foreign Agents Registration Act. So that's one question. And then the last question I'll take from Joana de Dos Pereira. How have private military companies, namely Russian, unbalanced the development of hybrid warfare? So one is about transparency, the other one is about hybrid warfare. And then I think I will have to close it, otherwise people might have other meetings.
Yeah, you're talking about the Magnitsky Act, or a British equivalent of. Yes, absolutely right and proper, well overdue. Transparency has not been a feature of Russian activities or foreign intelligence services activities in the UK in the last decade. It's a feature of my chapter on Brexit. So yes, absolutely, unequivocally in favor of greater transparency. In terms of the private sector and private military companies, yeah, big problem area. Quite often they've been used by Russia to go after people and companies in various parts of the world, and used again to help and aid the oligarchs who are looking to either pursue or enhance existing opportunities. And there are a number of active companies I could name. It's a separate issue. I'd happily talk to you about it separately, I really would. But it's a really good question. It's another part of this sub-state, non-state ecosystem. And plausible deniability.
Right, I think we have the topic for one of our future presentations then. So that sounds very interesting. But let me thank Kris for this marvelous presentation. I think this has been absolutely outstanding. We've learned so much. We've had a really very, very good time discussing all these issues with you. I think that was a really excellent way to kick off our series, and we will organize more events in due course, so please stay tuned. We'll be looking forward to have you back with us for future events. And thank you very much again, Kris. And I'm sure we'll repeat this very, very soon. Thank you.
I'll talk less next time. Thanks ever so much, Christian.
Thank you. Bye.
Bye, everyone.
Bye.